something, because you're worried that the same thing's going to happen to other neighborhoods.
As you mentioned earlier, ours is a community that has faced a lot of really bad development. A lot of developers who've been moving and build another, or who simply don't care. And it's assumed by many that this community doesn't take interest in the development of our community, and that we are not capable of doing what happens one way or another. We know that we have a lot of open space available, and developers know that too. So it's very reasonable that we be protective of our
home. Quite the opposite, that you guys are very active, you're very local, and it's a good thing when that happens, because it allows for dialogue like this. And you know, like I said, we've taken it into account. We've already removed 3 lots from the developments. They were kind of in a state of flux. We were told they were going to be added, but then when we went to, so we put them into the map, but then we didn't have all the information at the time of filing, but we did inform planning that we would be bringing for the revised information. And then since the conversations, it was decided So the map and the application didn't actually coincide, but after the first meeting that I attended, we decided not to make that revision. So the map, the application right now is still for 36. The map will be revised to reflect that. So we're already, but then after Thursday, there will be further reductions to the new complex.
Okay, we're
going to
move on to the next group. Gentleman in the orange, do you have a question? Mr. McDonald?
Yeah, sure. How are you doing today?
How are you?
Thank you, Ben. I'm doing fine, thank you for asking. I appreciate you coming down here to our area to discuss this major project that we have. Have you spoken with the Department of Engineering Public Works that deals with the bridge and the maintenance function right now, so that I heard earlier about routes, which routes are going to be accessible for you mentioned, but with that whole concept of the bridge and adding signal lights and other, is that to be unison together? And also on another question, I definitely like to have more of this communication. I'd like to know about the art environment impact, where it's very important, and where this is going to. It's something that we have to be evaluating. So there's many more questions to ask. I simply put, some of the roads, they will be lightened. The roads possibly because there's a house on the north or south side will not be lighted because of the problem. But if the city says that we have an open space 24 feet in a certain area, are we going to look at roads that are going to be wide and narrow, something like that, because that's what's going to happen. And lastly, the fire department does need to have good roads to be able to get into urban areas.
Okay, I know that the ORF has opened dialogue with the city engineer responsible for the bridge. He passed the information on to me just yesterday. I have not had an opportunity to pass that along to David, but yes, we are opening dialogue to see what their plan, how where they are in their planning, what their timelines are, and how, and just to know how it will impact this development, because we understand that some of the improvements will be or should be beneficial to the traffic flows in this area. But we don't have those answers yet. Like I said, the contract was just made by last week, and we were just given the invitation yesterday. It's the same. You will be kept in the loop, and we'll leave on the EIR.
Did you say that it hasn't been required yet by the city?
No, we're just meeting. I'm just meeting the environmental planner on their stop. That's the environmental assessment form. form was filed, the application was required. It appears, whether there's an initial study has been done or not, I don't know. But it does appear that they are sufficiently into it that we are going to open a dialogue about what document they're going to require.
I know he was working on that.
Yes.
That will keep everybody out of the day. And then lastly, the fire department, can you move in the road?
And you also have white engineer. The city doesn't generally like to go wide narrow, it's not a good aesthetic if you drive down the street. They do require whatever the minimum width is. I know that another project that Ms. Farmer did, we actually went out and surveyed kind of a couple thousand feet of road so that you can go in, make improvements, fix all the potholes, widen all out the front, use the minimum required, and did that before you start. Before you got approval for the project, you got permission to go ahead and do that. He understands the issues. I don't know if he's doing it because he wants to get the equipment up there or because he wants to get the fire trucks up there, but he understands the issues of having good circulation to the project site. As far as putting curb and gutter all the way down, most likely the city wouldn't require that, and because he really wouldn't require you to do improvements of that nature on the front end of your property. They can't require him to get whatever the fire department requirement is from his property to wherever it is right in front of the fire department already.
One more left.
Yes. And lastly, Mr. Monroe should be here to be able to hear the complaints that are, I mean, most person I know had flat tires on his car with the nails that were left behind. And that's not working. Whether he's the worker or not, he needs to be able to assess these issues. If you want a positive reaction towards it,
there are two separate mountains. I mean, I don't know if we can adjust those or should be adjusted either, but do you have his contact information?
Only get it.
Okay.
We do understand the sentiment that whatever he does, he doesn't ask for the future, but okay. Obviously, for this project, is okay. Just.
Next, sir.
The project started out. For 27 hours, is that correct? And then it jumped to 39?
Well, he actually bought more property, too. Because originally, you didn't want to be bought this lot, or maybe these lots above, or Forest Park. Once he added that, he gave him additional acres that he could when you take the whole thing as a project, it's something like 5,000 square lots. He gave him more lots.
So, what? How much space is going to be in between each house?
Well, this is a small lot subdivision. It's a small lot subdivision. The ones that I've done,
two to eight inches.
Typical small lot subdivision. So, these actually have a little bit more than most of them. One that you guys still size.
Don't require 2 inches. That's wide enough technically for a garbage truck or a
Fire truck.
Does that include parking, street parking?
Yeah, off-street parking. We put parking spaces throughout the project. We don't have enough, there's parking distributed throughout.
So the folks will be able to park in front of the house?
No. There's no driveway.
If there's no garage, is it?
There's a two-car garage. Each unit will have a two-car garage.
But no street parking?
It'll go.
No street parking.
Are they going to put up signs that say that?
Yes.
Oh, absolutely. I'm sure that will be, we generally get conditions from DOT, Bureau of Engineering, and I would be surprised if there wasn't a condition from one of them restricting the street parking.
Yeah, I have a couple questions. The first is, what's the typical order of a project like this? Because I'm hearing sweep streets, I'm hearing sewer, I'm hearing caissons, I'm hearing... So, how is that going to go?
Because it's hillside, it's not quite the typical thing that is in order to build. Normally, you have to have the roads and pavement before you bring the lumber and the fire department requires that. To build the roads, though, for this, because it's hillside, we're going to have to do the grading for the houses and build the walls for the houses. The walls themselves are going to be pulling up the road. They're going to be assigned to all of them. So it's going to be one operation at the very beginning where you're putting in some portions of the structures to build the roads, put the pavement in, and then come in and finish up. Well, you have to put the utilities in before you pave the roads. So you're going to build the walls that require, put the dirt in for the roads, and you put the utilities in. Then before you pave it, you know, the sewer, the water, the gas, all that. Then you'll pave the roads, and then they'll go to the construction house.
So, logically then, the haul route would be up Palmer, because that's the most, the widest, most paved, most accessible street to the area. But, thank you. And then, have you ever tried to make a right or left turn off of Commodore at, say, 8:15 in the morning?
I have not.
Okay, because I can tell you, I've sat there for 5 to 10 minutes already between backwards, or Forever 21, the welfare office, the bridge construction, and everything else, and I can't even make a right for 5 minutes or so. And looking at that map, if I live on the east side of that development and I'm trying to get to downtown, I'm not winding through the back roads. I'm going to go to Commodore because it's the most direct route out to get me to where I need to be to get to work on time. So I guess it sounds to me like Commodore is going to be the most impacted street, especially at the beginning of this project,
right,
and probably throughout the project,
And then, like I said before, they don't try to do improvements in front of, except in front of your friendship property. So they can make intersection improvements if it's going to be, if your property impacts an intersection outside your property. So they may make them upgrade the signals, so they may widen the intersection so there's more green lights.
Change construction and less accessibility.
Temporary. It's all temporary.
Temporarily, but when you live there, that's temporarily, but it's a long time.
Yeah, I understand that.
Because we're already going through it with the bike lane and everything else that's happened in just that stretch of Huntington. It's been about 3 years of temporary for us.
I sympathize with you. We're already out here in similar situations. I cannot get out of where I live until the light changes down where I am. It's a very long ride. It's 5 minutes long. And there are major construction options down, so it used to be four lanes down to one lane in each direction. I understand the whole thing. And
so that's 39 more folks that.
Right.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I have a couple of questions here. Regarding the, if the project was approved, there will be streets resurfacing, correct? And my question is are guardrails budgeted into the construction? Or is the homeowner responsible for resurfacing the street? Going from the council, I'm bringing up because you know it's hillside and none of the streets have guardrails. So my question, that's my first question, are is guardrails into the budget into the construction? My second question is, if the project was approved, what is the time span for the construction from start to finish, how long will the project take? My third and final question was, you know, after all the gentleman here regarding parking, are you aware of how many streets around the construction area are rectified? And those are the questions.
Can you clarify the last question?
No, I have a question. So the first question about street resurfacing and guardrails. I doubt that they'll require us to guardrails, but if construction damages the streets and you're going to have all these trucks, they will require them to fix the streets back to the way it was before it started. Which means they'll probably fix it better than in that condition, but you can't say, oh, it's really damaged, I'm just going to damage it. So they will be providing research, and that they, any damage that they cause, any are required. Guardrails are probably not going to be in it, though, because that would be beyond, that's being an extra improvement outside the frontage of the property. So it would most likely not be required for them to do that.
Not required? There's so many streets up there, they just will street down.
It's scary, yes.
It's a public thing, maybe it doesn't.
Yeah, and the city should, well, whoever built the streets originally, you think should have done, but these streets were built back in what, the 30s, 40s?
20s.
And the timing of this, that would all depend, there's a lot of things on. One thing about the project is that it's clustered, so it could depend on the economics at the time, because you may divide it up into different phases and do one at a time, or if things are going great, you may do it all at once. I mean, I can't say for sure, but it is a multi-year project.
Keep looking at that, because during the summer time, certain streets you cannot park on, and with the employees who prefer between one parking on all the hills, during summer time, there's not going to be any parking.
Well, a lot of times the city requires on a project of this nature, they'll require them to park in front and rent parking spaces somewhere way off site and be shoveled up and they'll stay there all day and be shoveled down at the end of the day, so there won't be traffic or parking on the streets. And on some of this side, when they start getting actual construction,
they have a lot of workers.
The workers, yeah. That's usually what happens.
Do you have to deal with where they're going to park that?
They will have to, it would have to be off site, probably they would have to rent space at a vacant parking lot or something like that.
The distance
is regarding for this. It will make them find something.
Make sure that you address that concern, because they can put that in mitigation measures, because it can be one of the things that they can covenant for, in the covenants that they will, when they determine where the offset parking construction is going to be, that community, that the neighboring council be sent a letter. So, you know, yes, you can bring that up and you can make that request of the DOA. But if you have an RD 1.5, an RD 5, RD 6, then if you have 8,000 square feet in an RD 1.5, for every 1,500 square feet, you can plan a home. So you would divide that 8,000 by 1,500 and you would get the maximum number, but then you have to take out for the fact that you have to have a street because there has to be access. So in a typical 8,000 is what, four? It would be four. It would be four homes in a small lot on an RD 1.5 lot. The city, they're starting to monitor those small lot development because they understand the concerns like these that people are trying to cram too much and too little.
But the code is the code.
Yes.
So they can't monitor it outside the code. They can make suggestions. As per microgrant small lots, sometimes suggestions.
And they've also made some modifications. I'm not familiar with all of them. They have made some modifications to the ordinance over time. One of them, and I don't know if it's official or if they're just recommending at this point, but it was one that we took into consideration. When you start getting over 10 units, they're wanting open space. They don't want. This is a groundbreaker, when I talked to Jose Romero Navarro on this project, and he said, I'm going to be looking for open space. We took him seriously, because we want to, again, be environmentally sensitive and community sensitive as well. Whether it's officially in the ordinance that they're requiring open space for more than 10, I do not know. But like I said, they're recommending it and we took it.
Right, and now you'll be doing highway dedication of this project as well, right? If you are allowed to change your zoning, Jose Navarro Ramiro will suggest you have some highway dedication for parking, for guest parking, for these things, right? That would be what a normal development with what would happen in a normal development of this scale.
Yes and no. For a small lot subdivision though, it wouldn't necessarily be highway dedication, you just have egress easements and then easements for parking over these people's lots. Their lots actually extend in the middle of the road. So you're not really getting highway dedication like you would under normal traffic.
You said the lots go to the center of the road. Are you talking about the small lot subdivision?
Yes.
So all those people have easements for each other's lots, and they're paying on their APN number for the road as part of the project. And you said that there wouldn't be any guest parking available for
there is.
No, there is.
There's specific spots where you create parking spaces.
How many guest parking for a home?
I don't remember.
You
know
how many so?
The track map is a redrawing of the APN number.
So what is the square footage right now of one of your track maps? Of one track map that will look with one home? The track map is all of them.
The track map is the whole 177,000 square feet of the entire lot. But what happens is generally when the conditions are written, it will say the project is approved for a maximum of X number of units. So, and this is a vesting map. So that means that whatever is approved here, no matter how things change in the future, whatever is approved here is what has to stick. And even if they could get something better, the vesting is what is there. So if he loses all this funding and he's approved for 36, that no matter who comes in, that's the most they're going to be able to build. It generally says, and it can't say, well, it generally says 2A maximum up. So if he doesn't build 30, he's free to build something less, but he can't build anything more.
And how many lots does he currently own?
I'm sorry.
How many lots does he currently own?
Years? I think there's
two.
No, this is
this is one lot, and then there's this lot up there.
And without the zoning change, how many lots are you going to build?
If you calculate out the square footage and divide it by 5,000, it comes up to 35 lots.
Yeah, but
why doesn't he just go by right?
It's 36.
No, it says here, 39.
Okay, well, we're going to be I'm talking about the density without this acreage. I'm talking about the density without the additional acreage.
We're not looking at
it. No, he asked a question. If you did the R1, if you take the acreage of the R1 and divide it by 5,000, you come out with 35. There will probably be some less because you're going to have to do streets. I don't know how many less. If you have to do streets, but you're going to at least double your grade.
But we're talking about 35 lots. That's the skill set. You can't build the same amount, the same way on a flat surface compared to a hill set surface. You're only 35 homes, but at a level where it's that's
we haven't.
Well, we actually did studies on where talks about putting the gross zoom of the grain, we've got standards of subdivision houses on. So we're the 35 lots that were allowed, and I'm reading that are required to do that. And it's possible. It's not really nice. It's going to be a huge, massive amount of grading. You're going to have houses overlooking other houses.
But you can do that under the hillside zoning
ordinance.
Right. You cannot do it within the hillside zoning
ordinance. We need to keep it in one question and also we keep some order, but I do want to get to, like, there's three more residents and you have maybe a lot of questions.
I just have one more comment.
Okay.
All of these people that live in this area don't have sprinklers in their homes. And these new homes will have sprinklers. How well would it, if there's a total fire, how will the fire department with all these other homes there service all of these new homes and all the different people?
Well, first of all, you're saying that this guy that lives right here already, you're saying that he doesn't get good service right now and he should move out because the fire department can't protect him. And we're just barely beyond that for our house. We're just a few hundred feet beyond that. So it should be able to protect this. And we're making in all these corners, remember we have a corner started a project with, and if our alleys were having turnarounds, the fire department can get in there, they can turn around and get back out. So we're providing for the fire department's access to our property. And this really is not very much farther beyond where the road was in that rapidly huge, windy roads up on the top of the hill. It's, you know, where the roads are now, which is affecting the 200 feet. It's not like we're creating a project out in the middle of nowhere. Having to go off.
Sir,
do you have a question? Mr.
Mejia? Well, you know what? I just want to go back to the beginning of the meeting. You mentioned that you met with certain groups within the community, and you guys got approval from that community. I'm just curious to know, what groups did you guys meet with?
No, I didn't say we got, if it says we got approval, then it's a mistake. We were advised that we would My understanding is that we were advised that we would have support from these independent community people. The only people that I personally met with was the councilman's planning deputy and the councilman's office. Mr. Monroe is the one who advised us that he's been the one that's out in the community talking to people. He would have to be the one to speak to who outside of this room he's actually spoken to. I don't know the councilman's office and you people here. So this is still not what the councilman's office has indicated support for development within this community. He likes his deputy advises he likes the concept of our project.
What deputy?
You were not in that meeting with me, and he looked at our plan, and he said he liked the concept, and he felt that development in this area would be beneficial. This is what we were told. Okay.
I still have a nice
question.
Do you know what deputy name is? Or who the deputy was?
His name escapes me at the moment. I have his card back at my office.
Now I just have a comment. I know you guys are here on your own and you guys are trying to be as much informative as you can, but there's a lot of gap in your information. There's a lot of holes, so I know that everybody's asking questions, and there's a lot of things that you guys don't know, and I just go back to you guys. Maybe the property owner should have been here, and I don't know, maybe this meeting shouldn't have happened, but I just there's a lot of no answer questions here.
I understand that Mr. Monroe took ill. I have no control over that. I apologize. But we're not at the point yet where we're coming before you and asking for your official vote of support, or if you choose to oppose, you're going to write your letter of opposition to the councilman and to the planning commission. We're not at that point. We're at the point where we want this kind of dialogue. We want to know your concerns. We want to be able to address them because ultimately, we want your support. And yes, I understand that there are holes because I'm not the developer and I'm not the architect, but we have your questions and your concerns so that when we do come back, that those will be hopefully the first things that can be answered for you is anything that carries over from here that wasn't answered, so that we can hopefully then move on and help the project progress.
I also have to say that it is being videotaped, and hopefully Mr. Monroe will watch it, and then he can realize that the community concerns that it addressed in Mexico. I have a couple more to Ms. Garcia.
I'm good.
Thank you. Mr. Mateo, you're last.
Question?
Do you have a question?
Thank you guys for coming out here. I'll just do my name, Anthony Manzano. I'm going to sort of try to touch, not speak for the project at all, but just as a participant and a neighbor. I would say at least this is the fourth time that we've heard of this. And there's been several meetings twice already by the management team yesterday, one today and one about 3 weeks ago. So it's not like this is the first time that this group is approaching the community. Exactly what they actually
the second time that they approached the community. That's the second time. The year was four. They went four times.
Right. Some of you have only been to this meeting for your first time. So don't tell me that no, they haven't been here. Because you've been here, they've been here. Yes, this group, or not you specifically, but Raymond has been here. His other assistant, Firestone, something like that, right? He's been here. So there's other neighbors in here who can say that I should think here about four or five times. But I like your question, sir, most of all, because I don't know your name because I've never met you. But it was proposed under this small lot subdivision that, yes, it's possible that some of these homes can be built within 2 to 8 inches. And we heard this. We have engineers in our community. And we told them, no, we don't accept that. We don't want that because it is a fire safety concern. So that's why they made those adjustments just because of input that we provided. So what basically what's happening today is they will continue to retain your input, absorb it, and incorporate it into the project. That's the whole idea of getting community input or community support, not just to come and say, this is what we're doing, and you guys say yes or no. It's to sort of absorb what the neighbors actually want. Now, the other thing I'd like to mention is something that Victor brought up, which is the fire department. Because I've been very active with the fire department for years, and I'm very well aware of the streets by name that today the fire department will not put an apparatus on it. And guess what I feel like? Those neighbors are being underserved. So I talked to the fire department captain. I talked to Jose Ruiz about this. I even talked to the mayor about this. And I asked them, please improve the streets. Because right now, I didn't even interview by the news, that they will not put their vehicles on some of these streets. I feel that's a danger to some of the community members. So what they do is, now that when the project comes out, they will allow this equipment to now be able to use some of these streets that were never been able to use. And you can go talk to the fire captain right now. He'll tell you, down your right, Forest Park, Terminal Line, Cato, Dudley. I know the streets. He will tell you the same thing. But the fire department is not declining service. They just say they don't have the capacity to put your equipment on it. So I like this, that we're actually getting the community's input. I'm sure Raymond and this guy are going to include it into the project, and that's the whole idea of community involvement. We're not here to support it. I'm not saying go for it. I'm not on the land use committee, but I'm also not here to just say, no, we don't want to hear from you. The whole idea is participation, and that's what each of you guys are doing. I think you mentioned it, that's a little earlier. You sort of need to embrace and then give influence, and that's already happening because I've seen it. And if you want further influence, they'll come back a couple more times, they'll change the diagram, they'll change the layout, they'll change the specifications of the street width, they'll change the specifications on the home width, and what they're basically going to do is comply with the community's needs. But not only the community's needs, because they're under a lot of restrictions from the city already.
Okay,
Leslie,
that's what I'm glad is actually curious,
because this is part of the process.
I have a question on the parking. I guess it's in the 39 acres, but possibly it could be less.
The application says 39 acres.
Well, it's a 20-year home. My thing is, we start a parking for the guests that are coming, right? Are there going to be a time limit where the cars are here? There's a lot of kind of parking area. And the minute that the parking available, it's going to be tilted. So then, like, 24 hours, 48 hours.
Or is there anything?
Or is it going to be whoever parks that you got?
I did have one question.
So parking questions?
Parking questions? I've called them before, and they don't come. I don't know if it's the city thing, but the county's there in an hour. City, LA City, does not come. So I think it's a restriction on the parking.
I would assume there is. If you guess parking, there's no residents allowed to park there, no over 90 parking. I don't know what the users have, but they would. Is it really for the application condition to put it in their CCNR as a requirement so that the homeowner association would enforce it? But I don't see right now anything about what the parking is really on those systems.
Showcase the right thing. And I'm glad that you came, and you that's not the community to me. My perspective, because of the LAC-USA expansion, and again, diversity in the community is good.
Okay, thank you. So we have like 5 minutes, and now we have two questions, so please, a question.
So, what's the development-inducing implications of this project? In other words, you put in the improvements on the street, on the sewage, etc. How much other development could happen as a result of that and the surrounding properties? Because once you put in improvements, then other property owners can then sort of just attach onto it.
That's a good question. So one that people are always worried about, how much is their neighbor going to be expanded? But the project itself doesn't provide any extra utilities that anybody off-site can actually connect to, except for maybe in here, but everything is going to be sized for this project alone. And they would have to get special permission to connect to any of this, because it's all private on private property until it hits the public roads.
Are those empty lots back there that if the developer wanted to continue the improvements you have made?
Are you developing? Well, can you convey someone actually building the lots?
Are those empty lots back there?
They would probably make it more likely someone to buy them because now there's roadways, accessway, everything else in that area. Yes.
So could it be some further development?
Well, those lots are existing lots already. So you're not going to get, but yes. Those lots become more valuable to somebody because now there's, they're going to create facilities in the area that are going to be.
So what's the capacity for lots on, how many houses could be built in the open space that remains, if you estimate?
Here?
Behind.
On a full forest park, rising.
And up here, most likely, we still have all these trees that have to be brought up to them. We're not bringing anything up here that's going to help them. The only thing we're doing is making this connection here. So up here, I don't know, other than the fact that you're creating a new development that's going to make it, this is a nice place to go and develop. I don't think anything up here is going to be more valuable because of what we're doing. But anybody in the immediate vicinity probably.
And final question, can you give us a list of other developments that Mr. Monroe's done in Los Angeles? So we can see what they
are. I can ask him to provide that.
That's
right.
Yeah. Anthony, last question?
Yeah, my question is, I guess the layout or terrain of the property size or the lot size as a whole. And then you said if you divide it by 5,000, it gives you so many parcels or homes that you can build on it. At the intersection of Reno and Amethyst, there's like four homes that are within a few inches of each other. And also on Amethyst and East Roseville, there's homes that are just built next to each other. Why are you coming to ask for a zone change and not just build by right? And then forget about all of this and do what you need to do and be stuck with 35 homes instead of 36. Because if you just do the multiplication, like you're saying, division actually, get the total square lot size, divide it by the 5,000, say it was built 35 houses. Now you don't have to ask nobody, just build by right.
Well, we still have to create the lots. And then you still have to show that the lots are going to work. You still have to show that the amount of grading and retaining walls and everything else are going to be acceptable, which is a real problem. Because when you strike in the soil, exactly, you start building on something of that scale, then you have all sorts of problems to make the project properly feasible financially.
So it's economically feasible to do the zoning change?
Well, yeah, that's part of it, right?
Part of it is, economics. You know, we try to create a meeting between community, economics, and environment. By doing this as a cluster comes rather than spread out comes, again, nowhere on that document that it states why we'll post. I know it doesn't have to. I'm just saying that it doesn't, there's, but we're going to be made, you're to send this to police office, you're going to send this to Mike Grand, and we're going to be made aware of it, but we have no way to respond to it because there's no information. It just says, we oppose. And, I mean, we're here. We're here because we want to understand your concerns, so.
Okay, so that's everybody's question, but our time is up. We're not going to extend the meeting because we do have some workers here that we need to go home and respond. So, I think I need a motion to adjourn. At this point, the committee is not ready to take a position.
We have another meeting.
We're definitely going to have another meeting. We need to get to the room here, and we're not ready to take a
position. And then, I'd like to recommend that we make sure we get somebody from C14 at the next meeting.
Okay, yeah, Kevin has invited, so I'll make sure that we're ready for the next one. And so, by unanimous, we have a motion on adjournment seconded, and we're on to your meeting adjourned. Thank you.